Hello, my name is Denis and you are watching Close to Algo Trading. In this video, a short update of our previous environment, a brief description of QLearning and DQN agent, implementation of main learning steps for DQN, and test results. So, if you remember, we created a simple trading environment. But in this environment, we use synthetic generated data. Now, our environment receives a data frame with historical data as input parameters, and our observation specs looks like this. It's a dictionary with two keys. Price that contains 20 elements with open, close, high, low, and volume data. And POS that contains information about our open position. Whenever a new episode begins, we randomly select a slice of 20 prices from our data. Now, let us see what the reinforcement learning agent can learn from our environment. But before we create an agent, we need to know what it is. I will take a simple DQN agent for this video because it's already well-known reinforcement learning agent. And maybe you're already familiar with the concept of QLearning, where we assign for every pair of state and action so-called Q value. This table is called Q table. Then our agent looking up in the table with all our Q values and selects the action with the maximum Q value in the current state. The agent walks through the environment states, receives rewards, and updates Q values. You will ask me, how do we update the Q value? To update the Q values, we are using the following formula. Well, for us, it's especially important to understand that for the update of Q value, we must know the future Q value. For example, starting from the state 1 and we select action 2. You can see that the Q value associated with our pair is equal to 20. So, it's our old Q value in the formula. After we take an action, we got state, for example, number 4. From our Q table, we can see that for this state, action number 3 has a maximum Q value. This value is our future value. With the resulted value, we are updating the Q value associated with our starting pair, state 1, action 2. The Q table working well for a small environment with a few actions and state, but in our case, the financial market, we have a very wide state space. So, we can't use a Q table. But what should we do? Well, smart people came up with a solution. Instead of a Q table, we can use a deep neural network, which will predict the Q values from a given state. They call it DQN agent. Deep Q network agent. Unlike a Q table, in a Q network, the Q values are updated by minimizing the loss through backpropagation. And the loss function is given by the following equation. So, the learning step will be the following. Assume that we are in our current state and we are choosing some action. After we perform the selected action, we get the next state from the environment. We use our current state as input for our Q network. And an output will be a set of predicted Q values. Then, we use the next state as input for the network and we receive the set of future Q values. Then, we calculate our target values and training our network. Here is one important point. To be able to train a DQN agent, we need to have at least two observations. Well, now we have all information for our next step, where we will use the TensorFlow agent framework and create a DQN agent that will learn how to play with our environment. In general, the trading algorithm looks like this. Create an environment, create an agent, collect data for your environment using some policy, train the agent using the collected data, validate your agent, repeat from step 3. Step number 1 is very simple. We need to create our environment and wrap it into TFPy environment. It makes sense to have two environments, one for testing and one for evaluation. In the second step, we have to create a Q network for the DQN agent. The TensorFlow agent framework already has a Q network class, and we can simply use this class to create our Q network. Normally, input of the Q network is environment observation, and output is Q values for all possible actions. So we need to provide information about our observation and actions. Our network will consist of one hidden fully connected layer with 40 neurons. And as our observation is a dictionary, let's define a simple preprocessing layer for it. In the same way, we can create and use with our agent a QRNN network, if we want. So, the network is created, now we need to create a DQN agent. TensorFlow DQN agent class implements training of the Q network. We can easily instantiate an agent using DQN agent class. As you may see, we are passing our Q network to the agent constructor. Our Q network is normal neural network. That is why we need to define optimizer and the loss function. To be able to train our model, we need data. Normally, we will collect this data from our environment using some rules for action selections. For this step, we can simply select the action randomly. Well, DQN agent consists of two policies. Agent policy, the main policy that is used for evaluation and deployment, and collect policy, a second policy that is used for data collection. How does the data collection work? We take the current state and choosing an action. Then, we receive the next state and reward, and we store all this information in a buffer. So one step data called trajectory. We collect so many steps or episodes as we need for one training cycle. This common pattern for data collection is already implemented in TensorFlow agent as a driver. We will use here dynamic episode driver for collecting complete episode. With this driver, we will collect the step until the end of the episode. The driver accepts a list of observers that will be updated during the data collection from the environment. One of the most important observers is addBatch method from the reply buffer. I will use the most commonly used reply buffer in TensorFlow agent, TensorFlow Uniform Reply Buffer. To create this buffer, we have to define following values. The specification of the data elements that the buffer will store, the batch size corresponding to the batch size of the buffer, and the max length number of elements per batch segment. Well, after the data collection step is done, we can train our agent. The agent needs access to the reply buffer. This is provided by creating an iterable dataset pipeline which will feed data to the agent. As you remember, each row of the reply buffer only stores a single trajectory. But the DQN agent needs both the current and the next observation to compute the loss. So, the dataset pipeline can sample two rows for each item in the batch if we set number steps parameter to 2. In the case of RNN network, we have to set number steps to the train sequence length plus 1. Okay, let's go to train two DQN agents on the same data and see how they perform. For this test, one agent uses simple Q network and another one QRNN network. Both agents are using 200 days of the historical price data for training. We can see that after 700 training steps, simple DQN agent didn't learn a lot and mostly show a negative average return. But QRNN network agent mostly shows positive average returns. So, it makes sense because the RNN agent can see some dynamic in the data and learn faster. Well, the simple experiment gives us a dim light at the end of the tunnel, and a hope that we can use the reinforcement learning for building a profitable agent. Sure, we can't use our agent yet, and we have to check another matrix to measure the performance of our agent. But this topic I will leave for another video. Thanks for watching and see you in the next episode. Bye!